Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's Art Science Dialogues, Ultimate Dream of VR. My name is Ai Jing, and I am the Art Science Junior Project Manager at Swissnex in China. Just a little housekeeping before we get started. The webinar today will last 1 hour, including two presentations, 20 minutes each, and 15 minutes Q&A session. The webinar will be recorded, and we will share the recording and the presentation slides with all the registered audience afterwards. If you have any questions to our speakers, please type them into the Q&A box in your Zoom control panel. So now, without further ado, let's welcome Cici for the opening remarks.
Good afternoon in Shanghai and good morning in Switzerland. It's been a while since our last Art Science Dialogues. And from the participants list, I see quite some new names. So as usual, I'll give a brief introduction to our organization before we start our dialogue today. Swissnex in China is the Science Consulate of Switzerland in China. As part of the Swissnex global network, we connect Switzerland, China, and the world in science, research, education, and innovation. Our mission is to support the outreach and active engagement of our partners in the international exchange of knowledge, ideas, and talent. The five main Swissnex locations are established in some of the world's most innovative regions: Boston, Brazil, China, India, and San Francisco. Swissnex is an initiative of the State Secretariat for Education, Research, and Innovation of Switzerland and is part of the Swiss Confederation's network abroad, managed by the Federal Department of Foreign Affairs. The webinar today is part of our Art Science Dialogues initiated in 2020. This series not only presents artistic projects which scientists and research engineers are deeply involved in, but also looks into new initiatives and trends. Through the dialogues between artists and scientists, we're trying to stimulate the exchange of ideas between the two different worlds and explore opportunities for collaborations. And today, we've invited Mr. Bruno Herbelin, scientist from Laboratory of Cognitive Neuroscience, Brain and Mind Institute at EPFL, and Mr. Max Rheiner, CEO and founder of SOMNIACS, Birdly. He's also the lecturer of Interaction Design and ZHDK to present their research and projects in immersive virtual reality, followed by discussion and Q&A. Last but not least, with the support of Pro Helvetia Shanghai office and Swissnex in China, Birdly is currently on show at the Shanghai Biennale, hosted by the Power Station of Art. For our audience, if you're in Shanghai, don't miss it. Now I'll hand over to our first speaker, Bruno Herbelin, to present embodied and disembodied virtual reality. Bruno, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Cici. So let me share my slides. So thank you for the kind introductions, and I'm very happy to be here today and to be with you in overseas in China. Here, a rainy morning, and hopefully some exciting science and project collaborations with Max. So this presentation will be about embodied and disembodied virtual reality. It is an attempt to show you how VR and the neuroscientific study of bodily self-consciousness goes hand in hand in my work and in general. So if you think of the brain and the representation of your body in the brain, you might think of the homunculus. So it is the representation of the motor and sensory areas over your cortex, the top regions of your brain. And you might know already that your body is represented in a map with the fingers in one area, the legs in another, and the surface and the amount of neurons, if you want, representing each of them is proportional to the use that we have. For example, we have a large representation of the hands because we have a high dexterity, high representation of the tongue because we speak and it's a very mobile muscle, but we have lower representation, for example, of the legs or of the trunk, although it is very essential for who we think we are. So if you think of self-consciousness and bodily self-consciousness, meaning the consciousness of having a body, how would you do that? Would you just make the sum? Like I put, I take an area of the arm and of the trunk, and I have the body. But if you think also, it's multisensory because I can see my hand, I can feel it, I can move it, and if I make a sound, I can hear the sound of made with my body. So it is not merely a sum of the elements, it is a construct based on that. So how do you study your subjective experience of having a body? So this is a kind of experiments which are done in labs. So if you see on in front of you, you have a man in blue, and he is facing a plastic glove, a rubber hand in front of him. But he doesn't see, as you can see, there is a cardboard in between, he doesn't see his actual hand. What he sees is a rubber hand being touched, and the experimenter in green here is touching the rubber hand simultaneously. So look, it's touching simultaneously at the same moment. And what happens then is, as you could see, I replay, that you have a sudden threat on the hand. And what would be the reaction of the subject? So it's interesting to see that in the menace of the fork, the subject removes the hand, which he believes is his. The threat comes from his right, and he doesn't remove his right hand. He removes his left hand because he believes that this is his own hand. So this is called the rubber hand illusion. It's famous since 1998 with the Botovnik and Cohen paper. And it has been done since millions of times, and in a more controlled environment than the YouTube video I just showed you. More usually it's done with the box, which you hide your actual hand, you show a nicer representation of the hand. And what you would measure, for example, is the plots on the right, drift, meaning asking to the subject where he feels his hand is located. He would point not towards his own hand precisely, but shifted a bit towards the rubber hand. And it is important to know that it's only in the case what we call the synchronous condition in black here. So if you touch and feel the touch at the same time, you have this illusion that it is your hand. If it's incongruent, if it's asynchronous touch, then it's just somebody else's hand, it's just a plastic hand in front of you. So you say, well, okay, this is body, this is a hand, every hand look alike. So researchers have been trying to do the so-named unfacement illusion, which is the idea that you would see another representation of a face in front of you as if it was in the mirror, although it is not exactly representing you. So here is the experiment that we designed in the lab of Professor Blanke some years ago. So you have a subject who is turning the head like that and seeing herself either synchronous or asynchronously followed by a virtual face. So in more details, the procedure is as follows. Subject would be tracked with sensors in the back, would have peristereo glasses to have the correct vision in the virtual mirror. And as she moves the head left to right, an avatar in real-time 3D graphics head would turn simultaneously in the same way or asynchronously. The idea would be that this face is not exactly the face of the subject. It's a woman still, but it's not looking alike. And what we would prepare in advance is from left, a photo of the subject, to the right, a capture of this face. We would do all the morphings from 10% you, 100% you, so like 10% morphing, to 100% the avatar, with the interesting mix in between, which is 50%. And every time after the exposure to the virtual mirror, we would flash quickly this picture, this morphing, and ask the subject, yes, no, is it you or the other? So it's forced choice, rapid decision. So you make mistakes. So when you make mistakes, it becomes interesting for psychophysics and cognitive neuroscientists. So the normal result of this thing is not that you are perfect, is that when it's exactly you, you make 100% correct. If you are 100% the other, yeah, you identify, and the mistakes in between would progressively go towards the other. What is interesting is that if you have an asynchronous condition, meaning it's never really you because it's not following you, it's just a screen displaying somebody else, you have the perfect curve of the pre and post exposure synchronously, exactly matching. What is interesting is that after, between the pre to the post, after a synchronous condition, you see this shift here, meaning that you were exact at 50% making the change to say, well, this was me, this is the other. And after only 2 minutes of this exposure, now the shift is at 60%. That means just 2 minutes of a virtual mirror like that, and you already start to be less good at identifying yourself in the mirror. And what about the full body? So this is a typical work we conduct in the Blanke lab in EPFL. So since this Lengenager paper in Science 2007, we have used this paradigm quite a lot. It consists of a camera placed 2 meters behind a subject, subjects wearing head-mounted display, which shows the content of the camera. Meaning, if the camera is behind you at 2 meters, what you see is your own body in front of you at 2 meters in front of you. It goes as follows: the subject come, we equip them with a head-mounted display, adjust, and what they see. And then, like in the rubber hand, we would touch this body. So we would use a stick to touch the back of the subject. And during a few moments, we would repeat that and show this body in front of you, 2 meters in front of you, being touched in synchrony with you. What happens then is that you believe now that your body is in front of you, and that detached and disembodied you from your own perspective body. What's the impact of that? First is scientifically, you can show that there is a drift towards. So if you are asked again to show where you were, you have a drift to go towards this virtual body. It is body specific. If it's a cube, as we have shown here, for example, it doesn't work. It's you cannot really identify with a piece of wood in front of you. But more interestingly, this has some bodily impact. We have observed, for example, a decrease of temperature during the exposure to and this disembodiment, meaning as if we were disembodied, we have this less sensation of your own body. And this is confirmed with this analgesic effect, which is the same also for the rubber band, is that if you have a disembodiment towards this distant body, you feel less sensation on your own body. It's like if you project your body to be elsewhere. So you would ask me, what's the link with virtual reality? Well, I mean, it is important to notice that, to remember that the virtual reality really started with the idea of representing your body inside the world, like in this example of 1989. And in fact, if you look at what is immersion in virtual reality, it is all this technology which would replace the real world by the virtual world. And what is the interface between this is your body, meaning the sensors placed on your body and the displays placed on your head replace for you the perception of the environment, meaning that you have this sense of immersion in this immersive virtual environment, as it's called, if you have this replacement of your sensation. And that leads to this presence, this sense of being elsewhere, telepresence if you want, like being teleoperating a robot. This was first studied in the 90s. For example, you can see on the right this work from the Tashi lab in USA. At the time, they were trying to teleoperate robots, and you see the head-mounted display was enormous, so heavy that it has to be held by mechanic arms. But what is interesting is that when you explore this, as Howard Rengel did in the early 90s, that you realize that you are leaving your body. He has this anecdote that he was controlling this robot and turned the head to the right. And when he looked there, he suddenly saw a body and he realized, wow, who is this person? Oh, he's wearing a head-mounted display, but he looks like me. He moves like me. Oh, this is me. Oh, so suddenly he realized he was out of his own body. It's very much like what we would have in a neurological mechanism of out-of-body experience. Being there is this sensation, this movement of your experience of the world from where you are, in your where your body is, to where the virtual body is. That's what we study in the lab too. So example here on the left corner, you can see this is a view you have when you enter on the left into the virtual room. This is an experiment we conducted in 2010. So its graphics are not as good as today, but you see that there is a girl in front of you and there is a woman in front of this girl. And then you would shift to this first person perspective in the body of the girl with the red skirt. So for this experiment, we also used EEG, so we recorded. I will skip that. So simply when the subject was ready, we would show him the room, the virtual environment, starting at distance. You see that there is this girl in front of you. And at one point, we would have a visual effect, you can see on the left now, which teleports you inside the body of the girl. And then you are now facing this woman in front of you, and this woman raises her hand towards you. And as she does so, the experimenter does the same. Here it's me playing the trick, and I touch the shoulder of the subject at the same time in synchrony with this virtual woman. So what the person experiences is this virtual woman touching himself. What is important then is to quantify this effect. So that's what we did experimentally. So we had questionnaires and EEG. I will focus on the questionnaire here. So what is interesting is that when you ask subject, do you identify with this little girl body? If you are in first person view, synchronously touched by this virtual woman in front of you with the touch you felt, you have a very strong, as in the left bar, a very strong identification. If it's asynchronous, it's much less strong. And if you are now a third person view, like not in that body, it's even less strong. Same happens with if you ask, do you feel that you were wearing this red skirt? If you change clothing, of course, it's the same. Now you feel you had this, you were wearing these other clothes only if you were embodied in first person. Going further, we developed another technology using 360 capture. So here the subject is surrounded in 360. I mean, looking at 360 video, when you say it's pretty classical today, in the 2010, it was a bit early. What we added was this capture of your own body. As you can see, the subject can see his own hand so that he feels interacting with the object in the world. When you use this experimentally to measure your memory, meaning your episodic memory is your souvenirs of what you felt, what you remember as being lived through. And then you do an fMRI of the changes. You see an important difference, not only in the amount of elements you remember, but also in what was encoded in your brain between if you had a body and not a body. If you experience something in VR, which you were present in the world, in the virtual world, seeing your body inside, you remember more than if you were not present physically. But we are not the only lab doing this. Here is the lab of Mel Slater doing classical experiment with embodiment. Usually you wear a full body motion capture suit, see yourself in front of the mirror, and you can wave at yourself, and then start to experiment. So here is the work when they worked on the racial bias, but maybe I can show a piece later, just this piece of video. So So you are embodying the body of a woman, as a woman or a male if you're male, but then you switch color of skin. You can embody the skin of a black woman if you are a white woman, and conversely. And then you would do exercise of physics, sports, Tai Chi exercise in front of you and seeing yourself for a few minutes there. And what happens, this is an earliest paper, not exactly the same graphics than I showed before, but the same principle. If you embody a light-skinned person, avatar, as you are light-skinned, you are increasing your implicit association racial bias, while if you embody a black body, a black skin character, you are reducing your implicit association task racial bias. So this implicit task is something you do afterwards, flashing images, associating words with skin color. If it's not about racism as a political statement, it's just about the fact that if you're not accustomed to people of another skin color, you would have this tendency of being slower at reacting. While if you are accustomed with this, you are more fast in reacting. And this bias is the difference you have post and after. So you see, you can reduce people accustomed of implicit racial bias just by a few minutes of VR. In the artistic world, here is an example of Gilles Jobin and Artanim, who let people experience in full body their own body and the scale, and see, experience what it is to be small or large, experience their own body, and dance with these choreographers. And here, on your right, you can see this is one work we did in collaboration with Max that you'll hear now, where we tried the Birdly simulator for fly, and we've shown with the work of Myung Song that if you have a synchronous avatar, as compared if your avatar is asynchronous, you would have this difference in being able to fly. You are better at targeting objects while flying if you embody your character in first person view than if you don't. So I hope I gave you a little overview of this embodied virtual reality idea. Considering that embodiment is very spontaneous and basic neural mechanism of your bodily self-consciousness, and that virtual reality allows to experience what it is to be disembodied or to be re-embodied into other bodies, it is the playground for cognitive neuroscience research to explore how this can impact ourselves and how this can change in the world, in your life. So with this, I thank you for your attention. I thank you all my collaborators from the Blanke Lab and from the Immersive Interaction Group. Thank you.
Thank you, Bruno, for leading us to explore the mechanism of embodiment and also through the angle of the science and empirical studies. So, and it sounds really like a philosophical and metaphysical question to perceive ourselves from time to time in the VR world. And definitely we're looking forward to knowing more about your research findings. So Bruno, thanks again for the fantastic and insightful presentation. And next, let's welcome another great speaker, the man behind the Birdly, Max Rheiner, CEO and founder of SOMNIACS and Birdly. So the floor is yours, Max.
Thank you very much and good day. I just will start my slide. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm glad to be here. And as Bruno mentioned, I will tell you a little bit more about our project, which used a lot actually of the findings of what Bruno talked before. And so I'm gonna talk I call it the flight of mind and the creation of a full body immersion. So first of all, let me show you a little example. Oh no, first of all, I want to mention, I teach at the Zurich University of the Arts, and I'm also the CEO and head of the company SOMNIACS, which produces now the device or the experience Birdly. But let me show you first of all, a little bit what Birdly is in a short video, so it's much easier to understand all the following parts we'll explain. We'll be right back. So here you actually saw the commercial product Birdly, which we started with the company SOMNIACS, but Birdly started much more early. So we started Birdly actually as a research project in the Zurich University of the Arts. And the idea why we did this project was more or less to find out the borders or the possibilities. How can you extend virtual reality besides only the visual or auditive apparatus? Usually when you talk about virtual reality, everyone thinks just on the glasses or the audio, but actually the whole body is neglected in that sense. And that was actually our motivation just to go into this. And when we thought about this kind of research, and as we are from the art school, we thought, how can we actually embed this in a project at the art school and do actually exploration in that area? And for us, flying was the ideal topic because flying is very sensual, it's sensoric, and a lot of imagination is bound to flying. And so I start actually my presentation with a quote from Otto von Lilienthal, which is a flying pioneer, which actually also died because of his experiments of flying. So to invent an airplane is nothing, to build one is something, but to fly is everything. And that shows how strong the wish for flying always was in humankind. And I mean, I can go back into history, and here we even saw depictions of Greek mythology, the fall of Icarus. Even in mythology, people were always dreaming about flying and how this would be possible. So flying was more or less a superpower in that sense. But here you see even drawings from Leonardo da Vinci, which spent a tremendous amount of his time to think about an apparatus, how we can fly. And so here you see, even nowadays, when you see a science fiction movie or a fiction movie in general, you always find something which is flying. And here in Avatar, of course, the idea, you ride a dragon, you fly with this dragon through the air, or Iron Man or Superman or the Marvels and all, everything you see flying in the dreams of people. Even our inventors made hundreds of patents, or thousands and even more of patents of ways to fly. And a lot of them actually spent a lot of their fortune and a lot of their dignity actually in this area. And the pictures you see, they are for us maybe funny, but at that time, most of them were serious attempts how we can actually achieve the goal of flying. And when I go now back to the project, I wanted to build a simulator which can bring you into the body of a bird where you can fly in a very intuitive way. But simulators in that sense are not an old story. I mean, we have simulators since nearly 100 years. We use them to train pilots. And here you see, for example, a helicopter simulator. But the big difference between our project and a simulator like this is that you don't embody in that sense a helicopter. You control the helicopter with the joysticks, and you look at the instruments, and you fly the helicopter in this kind of setup. But with Birdly, we tried actually to merge you with a being, as to merge you with a bird. And so you don't have this kind of elements. You just have your body and the first person, and you are a bird, and you flap in the air. And to do this, we actually studied the anatomy of a bird. And luckily, a bird looks more or less the same. Of course, it's a fast stretch, but I always say it would be much more difficult if you would simulate an octopus. But the bird has more or less the similar limbs, has wings, we have arms. And in that way, we could match actually the body into this kind of flying simulator to reach actually the embodiment to be a bird. And here you see a very rough overview over the first prototype versions, where we only had a fan. We even had their olfactoric feedback. We used the smell, but this now we don't use anymore because it's very, very exhaustive to clean, to set up. So it works for us only for a few hours. Afterwards, you have to clean it, otherwise the smell is bad. And so I would like to use it in the future, but at the moment it's a little bit too excessive. And so you see a platform. The platform moves you up and down, left and right. It rotates you in all directions. You have wings, you can flap it. You have the glasses, of course, and the audio headphones. And here you see actually in a few slides the whole process. At art school, we pride ourselves, we are very practical in that sense. We work very iterative which we call design thinking in that sense. And we really started from zero, from scratch, and build actually this kind of prototype in half a year to have an end version where we really can fly. And we tried every step and we adjusted every step. We build it on the go just to really at every step that we have an experience prototype which we can try out and evaluate. And here you see actually and how I use my students to test it, to prototype it. And you have a little example here. The fan is outside. And this was not a very good decision because we found out very quickly, if you fly down, the wind strokes you in the back, which totally destroys the illusion. And so quickly we actually changed this concept, but through this kind of methods of rapid prototyping, we found out really quickly what works and what's not working. And so after this, we decided, as when we finalized the research project with great success and we showed it worldwide, actually, we decided to start it as a company because we got several inquiries if they can buy it, if they can rent it. And the whole time we had this kind of inquiries to deal with. And so finally, we decided we start a company as a startup. And in 2015, 16, actually 16, 17, we had this industrial version ready, which was really meant to be sold to clients worldwide. And when I talk about the Birdly experience, I don't talk only about the simulator, because most people only think either you have the experience or you have the hardware or something like this. But for us, I have really to emphasize that the experience is the hardware and the software, the interplay of it. So it's at the end, the illusion which you create. And to build these illusions, you need actually the simulator for the full body feedback, and you need also the experience for the visual, auditive, and the whole interactive feedback, and which was very crucial. I always say to my students, the immersion is only as strong as the weakest link in this kind of chain. And if something doesn't work, then the whole illusion will break together. And here I show you actually the software experience side, since we developed the hardware. And we started actually first with cities. And you might ask why you start with cities. For me, cities were the natural habitat of humans, and you are flying as a bird, which is very strange maybe for most people. And that's why we thought, why don't we put this experience that you can fly as a bird into a city, because it's the natural habitat of humans and you are in the body of a bird. So you see the big difference in that sense. And here we started, of course, with New York, but of course we also created also an experience from Zurich, our hometown. Let me show you. Thank you. So here you see some, you saw the city of Zurich, but we also have New York, Chicago or Singapore and some several other kind of city experiences. And this was very great for the people. I mean, when you live in the city or if you want to explore the city, it might be very interesting, but virtual reality in that sense is limitless. And of course, we were not satisfied only to show actually a depiction of reality. We wanted also to show the whole potential, which is possible. And so, for example, our next experience was actually Jurassic Flight, we called it, where you embody not a bird, but you embody a flying dinosaur. And so we recreated actually a world where 150 million years ago, you could be a dinosaur and soar actually through this kind of Jurassic times. And you're actually a specific dinosaur. And we worked on that project with scientists, with paleontologists, which advised us how the animals might look have at the time, what the vegetation was. And there were some very funny side stories. For example, I was always stroken that the landscape didn't look too real for me because I missed actually the grass and in the plains. But actually the scientists told me, hey, at that time there was no grass. And so for us, this is very alien when you see this kind of a landscape, but that's what they actually advised us. And nowadays we show this experience mostly in natural history museums when they have a dinosaur exhibition in parallel. So you can actually embody the bird of a dinosaur and be educated in a very, very entertaining way. As I call this also edutainment. Here a little bit. So here you see some shots, actually some moon pictures, how we depicted it. So you see here Brontosaurus, of course, and the whole landscape where you can actually freely navigate. So with Birdly, it's quite mandatory or very important in that sense that you can navigate totally freely. So it's not a ride. And that makes actually for me the optimum of immersion, because if you're just sitting there and seeing the video, you just grasp a little part of the full potential of this, because you will see it when you try it and when you fly it and really navigate freely through this scene, then it's a total other level of presence. And here you see a little bit how we developed it. Of course, we had to create the whole landscape and the flight path and where actually the animals live and the whole animations of those kind of, this for example is Allosaurus. And and we recreated this, of course, all over the experience, because it's not a ride, as I said, you can navigate totally freely. And in, and you see actually in this world, the nature really plays out. So the some dinosaurs are hunting, some are just eating in the river, and some are migrating from other place to that one. And you can really just explore this landscape and find this kind of behavior patterns and how they reacted in the natural habitat. I jump over that one. And currently, as Aijing mentioned and Sissy, we are showing actually Birdly in the Power Station of the Arts. And this in the framework, I think, of the Biennale. And With Birdly, we mostly pride ourselves that we do flying simulations. But for me, Birdly was more or less a locomotion simulator, as a locomotion simulator which simulates gliding movements. So flying, of course, it's a very prominent movement of gliding, but we were also stroking and very curious if we could also recreate this underwater. And so in that way, we created our next experience, which we call Paradise Lost. And I'll show you a quick video of it. This comes later. But Paradise Lost was actually for us a project where we want to raise empathy for the oceans, because nowadays we hear about the climate change and the impact which sea life has. And for us, Birdly was always a very good device for embodiment and to raise empathy. And here you see some mood shots, some real shots of plastic trash in the oceans, or even this, this Q-tip, which has another passenger. And for us, it was very interesting to create an experience where we are actually underwater with our flying device, which is a gliding device, and show actually the devastation of humans, the devastating impact of humans on the oceans. And here we made all this kind of storyboards and ideas, what we can represent and how we should represent this. And for us, it was quite clear that we would like to be a turtle, because a turtle is a very cute little animal in the seas, which you can create very nicely, because a turtle has flaps and they are like little wings, and you can actually glide with those flaps or underwater. And here are some mood shots which we did from our experience, and here some later shots from the final experience, where you see manta rays which are majestically floating actually through your space. Here you see a video.
Imagine exploring the coral reefs through the eyes of a sea turtle. Swim through the living cities of the sea and meet turtles who show you around. Come face to face with large manta rays, or drift through mystical caves filled with life. But your underwater paradise is under threat. Experience firsthand the impact of human activity and understand what is at stake. Paradise Lost, an original Birdly experience.
Of course, this experience is meant more for the younger audience, because it's actually a very short one. It's just 2 minutes in that sense, but very intense. But we thought actually in that sense, when you use a turtle as an angle point to start the story, you have also friends as other turtles which show you around in this landscape and guide you actually through. And in that way, we could actually mix total free roaming experience with a storyline, because in that experience, we needed actually to have a storyline to actually to bring down the topic of climate change. And we choose actually another turtle which guides you in that sense, and you can follow it, and in that sense you really go in through this kind of mixed state of linear story and free roaming story. And here I just show you at the end our last experience, which we are just developing now. So Skyfall, a wingsuit experience, just a project title. And of course, now we want to go into a little extreme sport. We were interested as well that in skydiving. Skydiving, of course, is gliding. It's not flying in that sense. Some people might say different, but it's a gliding experience. And we are also quite interested to recreate this thrill of this kind of extreme sport. And here you see some concept arts, which we start. And of course, you jump down from Swiss mountains. And here you see some shots, how we start to plan this out, because all of this experience is quite important. It's VR, and it's important how we design this, that the experience really works out for the riders then in the future. And yes, I hope you had a very nice introduction to our project. And yes, I'm open for questions.
Thank you, Max, for sharing the story of Burly and also how you created Burly from scratch. So along with the incredible Burly embodiment as a bird, storytelling and software are also key to elevate the immersive experience to create this kind of illusion. I'm sure that your presentation is very helpful and inspiring for ambitious producer, designer and engineers. So a kind reminder again, if you are in Shanghai, don't miss trying Burly's remarkable experience at the Power Station of Arts Museum. And great, so we will go ahead and take some time for questions now. So yeah, are you ready? So the first question is for Bruno. So Swissnex in Brazil has featured your Verandola project in 2019, which is a great example that you are experiencing and also the body conscious and integrate respiratory interaction through VR. So beside that, Bruno, are there any new research or projects you're working on?
Yes, of course. So we are always super active. We have a long research, clinical research on the hallucinations and Parkinson's. So that's a more serious core of the laboratory of Professor Blanke. And indeed, I try to have always this exploratory little research where we reach out to other topics. So in these ones, a bit less medical, we've linked to medical. We are now trying in the Geneva Hospital a system with virtual reality in the MRI. In the the MRI, when you have a brain or body scan. And the problem is that many people are claustrophobic. And entering into this machine, into the tube, is very frightening because you are closed in a tube, in a small tube. So what we're doing is we are adding virtual reality to have people do the MRI while they feel being elsewhere, at least not being in the tube. And we are trying different settings. It's not about entertainment because we don't want them to flap their eyes because they should not move during the MRI. So it is a virtual examination room in which they should remain still and follow the instruction of the virtual doctor, but without the fear of the claustrophobic environment. So this is the kind of project where we try to explore benefits of embodiment for examination or clinical applications.
But so far, do you see any limitations of virtual reality can do in the healthcare section?
Well, the virtual reality has a lot of potential for pain treatment, for, as I said, removing the anxiety linked to the examination. And as my PhD was about, for treating cognitive and behavioral disorders. The thing with virtual reality is that it separates yourself from the real world. So that's a feature. And you have a lot of discussion and debates in the field of VR today in technology and in the news that mixed reality or augmented reality would be first, would be more interesting, more important, because you can imagine more selling, because you imagine you would have little Google glasses or little Apple glasses coming soon, and you would have them all the time, and you will have commercials all the time with you, not only on your little phone. So of course, commercially, it's more interesting to have mixed reality because people can do their real thing and you can add commercials. That's exactly the opposite I'm exploring. I'm rather exploring these moments when, as Max does, you take the time to have a specific experience, may it be for clinical application or for entertainment or for something. And this is when you can have the full benefit of disembodiment, of being somebody else, of really living something exceptional. That's what I'm working on.
Great. Thank you. And then that's the question for Max. So Max, from zero to one is never an easy thing. From having flying as a concept to finalizing in reality, what would you say the biggest challenge you encountered?
As for me, the technical challenge was tremendous, but it was not unsolvable. So for me, it was more or less to start this project and to convince most people, because when you are very innovative or you have something which is totally new, it's quite difficult to start a project like this. You know, there are always people when you look for funding, you always have to validate why you do it and in which way. And so, and for me, this was the biggest challenge. But of course, technically and artistic, it was tremendous, but that's something which you work on. But to start a project like this, yeah, it's the fun. That's the boring answer, but that was, I think, the most, the biggest challenge.
And also, could you tell us more about the new expansion experience about the Skyfall? Because you already show some teasers, like teaser, so you could get more experience. And also, I think there's one audience is very curious about, like, you know, like VR experience tends to be more like multi-sensory, which Bruno just mentioned before. Yeah. But would Burley consider to integrate other bodily embodiments, because so far it's continue with gliding, flying.
That's a very good question, because I'm totally full for all different kinds of full body immersions. And so in my research phase, I tried olfactoric as well, but I also tried force feedback. And I would love to bring this kind of techniques back, but in a commercial world where you have a Burley setup, so each sensor, each actuator increases the complexity quite dramatically. And that's why we actually now use Burley more or less like a setup. I always like to compare it to a cinema chair. In a cinema chair or in the cinema, you have a specified audio system, a specified projecting system. You have the setup actually to watch a movie. And for us, we have now this Burley platform, which gives you this full body immersion in the segment of gliding. And so for us, it's very interesting now to explore all different kinds of segments. You saw Skyfall, you saw the underwater experience. We are also currently planning actually a micro experience, as a macro experience, where you actually get into the body of a butterfly and see the world as an insect. So the whole scale changes then for you. And another thing which we are very keen to start and test actually is the multi-users, the social aspects. When you are in a virtual reality world, you can interact in that world with other humans through the simulation. That's something what we start with Skyfall, as with the wingsuit experience as well. You can race against each other, you can play. So this is more a gamified experience, but for other experience, we also think it's quite crucial and interesting to meet you there in this kind of new space with other people and interact them.
Totally agree. So there's a last question for Bruno. So Bruno, do you mind to give some shed some light on the current healthcare VR, like current situation? Because we know like VR is quite applied in the healthcare, but whether there's the really could cure a certain disease in a more mature way than rather than just a very an experimental approach at this moment.
Yes. Indeed. I mean, VR for medical application is a long story. Mostly it was rather sought as a tool for the medical professionals. Like you imagine virtual reality simulator for a surgeon. What is what I'm trying to push forward, and not the only one hopefully now, is that it's more also something for the patient. And mostly, yes, it's about the psychological benefit you can bring. It is, it's of course not an experience like Burley will not change your physics or cure COVID. What it will change though is your, speaking of COVID is not, we did work with respiration and virtual reality to alleviate the symptoms of breathlessness in COVID patients. You have, after COVID, this difficulty of breathing. You feel you cannot fill your lungs. And this is annoying, this is even painful. It's not a pain in the sense of needle pain, it's a pain in the sense of a more lower pain, like always there. And what does the virtual reality and embodiment gives you is a relief of that. So I really believe that a lot of the cognitive aspect of virtual reality can be used for psychotherapy, maybe for alleviating some symptoms or for helping you go forward with it, understanding it. And the last thing with VR in healthcare would be for empathy. So back to what Max was saying, back to my example of being somebody else. It's difficult sometimes to understand others, to understand the illness of your grandmother who has Alzheimer, or to understand what this person is, why is he always not able to navigate? Because he has a disorder, disability. It's not just with glasses, it can be visual disorders can be complex. So with VR, you'd start to be able to experience how others perceive the world, not only animals or birds, but also other people perceive the world. And this way you can better understand. So not only practitioners of medicine can be better at treating, but also just the family can be better at understanding and helping your family members. That's where I see VR can change things.
So I promise it's going to be the last question to Bruno.
That's good. Good. Thank you. And for Max, just to say, I love your idea of the bugs. I would very much imagine a multi-user where one is a human, one is a fly, yeah. And we are always eating the bugs. We don't like them. No. If you experience first being a fly and then you have experienced being the bug, you would then welcome the bee or the fly and not kill it.
Bruno,
and you would see scientifically you can make the study if you change the order, so there would be an order effect. Yeah. If you have first been embodied with Birdly into a fly, you are changing your behavior afterwards.
Yeah. Without kidding, we thought about this concept, you know, we already started to plan it. But there is one big challenge, which I think is very exciting, but somehow a fly for me lives in a different kind of time zone as a human. And so when you are a fly, then everything what the human does is very slow, you know, and this in real time is very difficult when you have a human and a fly. But yeah, but still.
We have to find a way, but that could be fun.
Yeah.
Sorry, I cut your question. I wanted just to.
Right. So there's a question from Frederick to Bruno. Could VR help to cure depressions?
It is already tested for that, yes. I mean, actually, depression itself, it's more the associated disorders which goes with it. Depression is always accompanied or often accompanied with mood disorders, with agoraphobia, not wanting to get out. In itself, virtual reality can be used for meditation, which is having a benefic effect also on self-consciousness and thus on depression. But it's not like a general one-size-fits-all VR simulation which will cure your depression. But definitely there are different symptoms. And I think in the future, I mean, I've always been enthusiastic. 10 years ago, I was going to say, well, in 5 years. So now I'm more cautious on the timeline, but companies will one day be able to finance this so that we'll have a large variety of virtual reality simulations, which can then be affordable. You download them, you get them, you try them, and you can find what suits you best. And all together will be a panel of solutions to help you, yes.
Great. I hope that also answered your question, Frederick. So due to the time constraint, we have to wrap up today's art science dialogue. And thank you, Bruno. Thank you, Max. We really appreciate you two being here. Our audience online, thanks again for joining us today. And if you have further questions, please send us email to artscience@swissnextchina.org. You're more than welcome to follow Swissnex in China official social media channels and keep in touch. So I see you all next time.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.